This is the new Ford Bronco, and it's the hottest SUV of the year by far. Everyone can't wait to see the new Bronco, to drive the new Bronco, to buy the new Bronco. Dealers have huge waiting lists, and Ford can't build them fast enough. And so today, I'm going to review the hottest SUV of the year. Before I get started, be sure to check out Cars and Bids, which is my enthusiast car auction website for cool cars from the modern era. We are offering free listings right now to auction your car on Cars and Bids to celebrate our 1 year anniversary. The free listings go through the end of this month, August, so be sure to check out Cars and Bids to sell your car. And we've had some great sales recently on Cars and Bids, including this Ford Raptor, which sold for $68,000, this 1997 Porsche Boxster with only 1,200 miles, which sold for $25,500, and this beautiful bright blue Chevy SS with a manual transmission that sold for just under $40,000. If you're looking to sell your cool car from the modern era, the 1980s and up, Cars and Bids is the place to do it, now with free listings through the end of August using the promo code BIRTHDAY when you submit your car. So let's talk Bronco. For years, the Jeep Wrangler has existed without any really serious direct competition. There have been sort of competitors, like the Toyota 4Runner and the old FJ Cruiser, the Hummer H3 and the Nissan Xterra for a little while, but nothing has ever focused a really close direct attack on the Wrangler, which is basically a cultural icon here in America. Or at least nothing took on the Wrangler until now. SUV sales have been huge lately, and Ford saw an opportunity to bring back the Bronco as a direct competitor to the Jeep Wrangler. So, this is two-door or four-door, just like the Wrangler, removable top, just like the Wrangler, off-road focused and priced, just like the Wrangler. This is Ford's answer to the Jeep Wrangler, except frankly, it's way cooler and way more highly demanded. Ford announced the Bronco last year and reception was massive, and it's finally going on sale now. For a refresher, prices start around $30,000 for a base model, and Ford is offering a choice between two engines. There's a turbo four-cylinder with about 300 horsepower or a turbo V6 with about 330 horsepower. Most Bronco models will come with an automatic transmission, although this one has a 7-speed manual. And there's so much more to cover. There are 6 basic Bronco trim levels, and fully equipped, prices can creep above $60,000. This one has a sticker price of around $56,000, and that's with the base engine and a manual transmission. And this Bronco is loaded with cool stuff, and today I'm going to show you all of it. First, I'll take you on a tour of the new Bronco and show you all of its interesting quirks and features. Then I'll get it out on the road and drive it, and then I'll give it a DOUGSCORE. All right, I'm gonna start the quirks and features of the new Bronco with getting in. Let's start with the key, which, as you can see, is just a regular Ford key on one side, says Bronco on the other. Nothing too unusual or weird here, but I thought you might like to see it. Anyway, once you open the door, you can see the door panel is all durable, tough stuff. No, like, nice leather, no stitching. It's all these tough materials, since they know this will be off-roaded. It's gonna get wet, dirty, whatever. You wanna clean it. So that's your door panel. You do have a little net for storage down at the bottom of the door panel. You can put like a wallet there, papers, whatever you might want. That's your little door panel storage area. And you'll notice on this door panel, you have a little power lock button, but you don't have window switches here. Instead, the window switches are located in the middle, in the center console between the seats. I suspect the reason they do that is the door is removable and they want to keep as many electronics as possible off of the door so it doesn't get damaged and so you don't have to like unhook it when you remove the doors. And by the way, speaking of tough, durable, muscular, off-roady, this grab handle to help you get inside mounted at the very edge of the dashboard. You have that on the driver and passenger side. You can stick your hand around it and pull yourself in. And you can see it's sort of rubberized. It says Bronco. It introduces you to this muscular interior of this new off-roader. But anyway, next up we climb inside the new Bronco, and you can see the durable, tough theme is certainly continued in here. Starting with just the look of everything, you have this upright 90 degree square rectangular dashboard. You don't have like flowing lines like you do in some cars with beautiful styling. It's supposed to be like brawny and tough and off-roady, and that's certainly the look they were going for in here. You can also see a focus on durable materials over nice stuff. Again, no leather, no stitching, no high quality wood trim or aluminum or chrome. It's all sort of durable, tough. That's really the ethos of this entire vehicle. And there are some interesting applications of the durable materials. For instance, this group of buttons on the top of the dashboard is all like thick rubber buttons that would be easily pressed if you were wearing gloves, and it's stuff that won't get damaged if it gets wet, those rubber buttons there. You have the same deal with the power mirror control. That's also in the center console next to the window switches, and you can see it's like rubberized, and you tap these rubber buttons L and R to switch which mirror you're adjusting, and then you move around this sort of rubberized joystick thing to actually adjust the mirrors themselves. Again, a durable material for this interior. Even the controls on the steering wheel are rubberized. You can see they're not typical piano black buttons, dials, switches, whatever. These are like rubberized controls, again, to help them last with durability when you take this thing off road, beat it, get it wet, muddy, whatever. And by the way, speaking of buttons in the new Bronco, I love that many of the buttons actually feature a little image of the Bronco. For instance, the traction control off button, you can see a little outline of a Bronco rather than a generic car. You can even see the little spare tire on the back, which is funny. Same deal with the climate control recirculating air button. You can see not a generic car, instead it's actually a Bronco with a clear spare tire on the profile of the Bronco on it. And the adaptive cruise control buttons on the steering wheel, same deal. You can see several different buttons that actually show the rear of a Bronco with that spare tire instead of just generic buttons. That's not something they have to do, but it does make it feel a little bit more special in this interior, and I like those little hidden Easter eggs. And speaking of little hidden touches in this interior, there are several exposed screws throughout the interior, as you might expect for a muscular vehicle like this one. The hidden touch is that the screws actually say Bronco on them. When you get really close and look closely, you can see Bronco printed on the head of the screws, which is kind of cool. One other interesting touch in that same vein, in the center, each Bronco will have this plaque that says Ford going across the center and sort of looks like the grill of a Bronco. And it says designed and engineered in Dearborn, Michigan, and tells you where it's built and their Michigan assembly plant. Just so you remember, this is a very American Bronco that you're driving. That plaque is kind of cool. But anyway, back to buttons and controls in this car. Possibly your most important controller in the entire vehicle is this one, this dial looking controller in the center console. This has a lot of different functions. For one thing, you can put the car into four-wheel drive. Little buttons up, down, left, and right will go into your various four-wheel modes. This controller also in the center has a little button that allows you to select hill descent control, which you're going to be using if you're coming down a steep hill. The car can actually sort of brake itself rather than having you do heavy braking and kind of drive itself downhill. That's a really cool feature. A lot of off-roaders have it, but I love it. But probably the very coolest function of this little controller is that it allows you to select between the different GOAT modes in the new Bronco. GOAT is an acronym for Goes Over All Terrain, and the modes are selectable, and they'll change the driving dynamics and the character of the car depending on which terrain you're on. And you can use this little dial to select each different GOAT mode for the exact type of terrain you're driving on to maximize your capabilities. Now, the Bronco is going to be offered with up to 8 GOAT modes, although the number of GOAT modes that you get depends on which trim level and options that you choose. Not every model has every mode. This Bronco Badlands comes with 7 GOAT modes, and one thing I absolutely love is as you turn the dial to go through them, you can see in the gauge cluster little pictures come up to represent each individual GOAT mode. Every single one has its own little depiction in the cluster, so you can see exactly which one you're in, and I think that's a cool touch, very neat, and it helps you identify exactly which GOAT mode you should be in. The terrain you're on should match the terrain in the gauge cluster. Kind of cool. And by the way, speaking of the gauge cluster, let's go through this because it's kind of an interesting situation in here. It's a little bit unusual. When you look in there, you see 2 basic items. On the left, you have a speedometer, which obviously shows your speed. And in the center of that, there's a giant circle for some reason. And then the needle, of course, goes around to show your speed. The giant focal point in this gauge cluster, though, is the big screen in here, full color, and it shows various different items. On the left side of the screen, it shows like a top-down view of a Bronco with lines next to it and like a square in front of it. That is supposed to show like your adaptive cruise control. The square in front will show how close you are to the car in front, and the lines next to you will show if you're like drifting over the lines while you're driving on the road. That's always there to kind of let you know where cars are around you and if you're going over the lines. Now, next to that little graphic, you have another speedometer and a tachometer, although they're vertical. You can see they like climb in this weird vertical manner. It's a very strange way to display a speedometer and a tachometer, but that's what you have in the new Bronco gauge cluster. Interestingly, that cannot be adjusted. That screen you just saw is the default that is pretty much always in place. You have the ability to configure the little part of the gauge cluster screen over on the right. And as you can see, you can adjust it to show like your average speed, your trip mileage, your fuel economy, that sort of thing. But the speedometer, tachometer, and that little Bronco display always stay put, and you can't configure that in this center gauge screen, which is kind of strange. In fact, I found that this center gauge screen is not as useful as it is in, frankly, a lot of different cars. For example, you can change the radio source in this gauge screen. You can go between AM, FM, Sirius, but you can't actually see what you're listening to. So once you select XM, that's it. It's all gone from the screen, and it goes back to the default screen. It doesn't show like the current song. It doesn't show like what phone contacts you have so you can call somebody. It doesn't show a navigation map in there. This is actually a pretty basic system considering they went with a gauge cluster screen. It's not as configurable as you might think it would be. But there is some good news on the technology front in this car. The gauge cluster screen doesn't have to be that great because the center screen is fantastic. This Bronco Badlands has the high pack, they call it, and that includes this 12-inch center screen, and it is wonderful. This is Ford's latest infotainment system. Huge screen, tremendously responsive, tremendously intuitive, incredibly easy to use, to figure out. You tap everywhere and it instantly switches to what you've tapped, just like a cell phone would. It's great. Comes with Android Auto and Apple CarPlay, like basically everything else now, as you might imagine. It's a really, really good system. You can see, go into the camera settings, and you have a very high resolution camera. In this model, you have a top-down 360 camera, which is really excellent. Using the navigation system is tremendously easy. You can just move around the map wherever you want by just adjusting your finger, swiping it, whatever, and entering a destination is also tremendously easy. It really is a fantastic infotainment system, this car, and it's like a cool dose of important modern technology in this old school vehicle. It kind of gives you the best of both worlds. I also love with these screens the little animations that come on when you get in the car and start it up. You can see the gauge screen has this like image of the wilderness, which is cool. Although the very best one is undoubtedly the center screen has this grand movie that plays. These sort of rocks assemble in the mountains to create an image of a Bronco, and that just looks awesome. And pretty much everybody who I've had in this car over the last few days has commented on how cool they think those little screen startup menus are. Everybody loves them, even though it's kind of a little gimmick. One last item worth noting with the screens, a lot of Bronco owners, old school truck people, will be happy to see that your main climate controls are still fixed hard buttons below the screen. So you can adjust like the temperature, the airspeed, where the air is coming out, your heated seats, all that stuff with actual buttons rather than having to go into menus on the screen. And the same is true for your main radio controls. You can adjust the volume, mute it, change the track, that sort of thing, all with hard controls, and you don't have to go into the screen for your main, most easily used stuff. But anyway, beyond the screen, some other interesting quirks and features in here. One is the mirror lights. You have these little buttons to the left of the steering wheel, kind of below the dashboard. You press them and they turn on these LED lights on the outside of the mirrors that light up very bright at night, so you can kind of see what's outside the Bronco. I guess like if you're camping, this could be useful. If you're just trying to see what's around before you climb out, whatever, you can manually turn those on the driver's side and on the passenger side. Another cool feature, this one is on the top of the dashboard in the center. There's a little power source here. You lift up this little cap and you can see USB-A and USB-C power ports. That's for a GoPro. Ford knows a lot of people are going to mount GoPros on their windshield, so rather than like running a cord from the center console, like most cars you have to do, they have a port right there, so you could just plug in your GoPro and go, and then record your drives while you're off-road. That's pretty cool. Next up, another cool feature, this new Bronco has curtain side airbags. You might not think that's cool and exciting, but it's a very good safety feature. A lot of studies have shown it's very useful, and you can't get it on the Wrangler. Jeep has said, we can't really make it work with the way the Wrangler is designed. Well, Ford made it work, and so this car, that's a big safety bonus to me, having curtain side airbags going across the roof rails, even on a vehicle with largely removable top and doors and such. Another cool feature in the interior, the glove box locks, of course. You have a little lock there. You can put stuff in there and lock it up. But since so much of this car is removable, you might want more locking storage than that. And so the center console also locks. You can see a little key lock here next to the latch, so you can lock even more stuff in the center console, which is nice and convenient. The weird part though is you gotta lock it with a normal key, but of course the car has a key fob. So every time you wanna lock the glove box to the center console, you gotta detach the key from the fob, then lock it, and then reattach it to get it back on your key ring. It's a little unorthodox, but it's nice to have those locking storage areas. Next up, another cool feature in this interior is the wireless cell phone charging pad. You can see it here next to the gear lever, and it isn't flat. You stick in your phone vertically and it will charge that way. That's really notable because most of these wireless chargers are flat, and that means it takes up a lot of room in this center console. You need enough space to lay down a large cell phone completely flat, but when it's vertical like this, it doesn't take up as much space, but your phone still gets charged, and it's neat to see that. Next up, another cool feature in here, on the ceiling you have all of these auxiliary switches, 6 different switches you can turn on and off. They don't really do anything right now, but they're pre-wired for accessories. That means if you want to put on like a winch or a big set of driving lights, LED light bar, whatever, you have pre-wired switches you can use to hook up to, and then you can turn all that stuff on using your switches. Another cool control in this car is this one here. Shows a little image of a vehicle with like one wheel up. That will disconnect the sway bars. A lot of cars, you want to disconnect the sway bars, you got to do so manually by getting under the car. In the new Bronco, you just press a button and it disconnects automatically from inside, greatly enhancing your off-roading convenience. And next up, you can't talk about cool features in the new Bronco without talking about the removable stuff. A lot of this car is removable to enhance the fun of your experience. I'm gonna start with the roof. Now, this Bronco is obviously equipped with the hard top, and in order to remove it in front, it's a pretty easy process. There are 2 panels, one over the driver's seat, one over the passenger seat. And to take off one of the panels, you just sort of flip these little plastic, like, switch things. There are 3 of them. You just move each of them to, like, the open position, and then you have a latch, like an actual physical latch. You pull on this plastic piece and that will release the latch, and then you can just lift the panel right off. Very simple, except this particular Bronco is equipped with roof rails, as you can see, and so getting the panel off with the roof rails in place is kind of annoying. There's not much space to actually do that, and it's a little bit difficult to remove the roof panel with the rails. And in fact, if you plan to own one of these and you plan to take the top off frequently, on, off, on, off, you probably won't want to order this with the roof rails. It just gets in the way and it makes it a little bit more challenging, but it is possible to remove the top with the rails on. As you can see, it's now off and you have the front open. You have like a Targa-topped Bronco experience. Now, worth noting, you can also remove the rear roof panel, but that's a little bit more challenging. For one thing, it's just one panel over the entire rear seats, which means it's probably a 2-person job. It's obviously a lot heavier and more unwieldy than these individual panels in front. And the larger panel means it's going to be really difficult to get it under the roof rails, frankly. You just slide like both sides under the rails. It'd be kind of a challenge to do, especially with one person. I'm not going to do it, but it is possible. However, again, if you want to take off the roof frequently, put it back on, off, on, you're going to probably want to skip the roof rails. Now, the other major removable item in the new Bronco is the doors. This is a big deal. You can take the doors off on a Wrangler, and so Ford wanted you to be able to do that on the Bronco as well, and you can't. It's not incredibly difficult. I'm not going to do it, but I am going to link to a great Bronco Nation video that goes through an in-depth explanation of how to remove the doors if you really want to see step by step. The basic gist though is you have to remove this little quick release connector for the electronics in the door, the power window and the door locks. You pull that off and then you use like a socket wrench to remove the actual door bolts, and then you can pull it off and lift the door. And amazingly, there's like a door handle at the base of the door, and it actually says lift imprinted in the plastic, telling you where to lift the door for easiest possible carrying capabilities. That's how you lift it and pull it off. Worth noting, these doors are pretty heavy, around 50 pounds each. So it's not like you just pop them off and throw them in the back. It does require a little bit of effort to get them back there. And they have individual door bags that they can go into, so you can stick them in the back and not damage them while you're driving along. Now, one cool thing about the doors in the Bronco is they are frameless, meaning they don't have like a frame that goes all the way around the window. That's a big deal because the doors in the Wrangler have frames, and as a result, it's difficult to carry those with you after you've taken them off, which means if you want to go off-roading without your doors, you got to find somewhere to leave them. So these doors, by being frameless, they're a lot smaller and easy to carry around, but it does highlight a little bit of a quality issue with the doors. When you have a car with frameless doors, the window has to go up just a little bit after the door is closed to make a seal with the weather stripping around the door so that water doesn't get in. And that means when you open the door, the window has to go down just a little bit to break the seal and allow you to open the door. In this car, the window doesn't go down anywhere near quickly enough, and so it kind of shakes against the weather stripping every time you open the door, and frankly, it just doesn't look that high quality when it happens. It looks like you're gonna break something every single time, and that's not great because that's the first thing you're greeted with when you first open the driver's door, that like shaking window not working properly coming down against the weather stripping just doesn't really look all that good. And in fact, that highlights kind of a general flaw with the Bronco that I wanna bring up, and that is, it's just not really all that nice in this car. I wanna make this point delicately but clearly. The Bronco isn't the nicest vehicle. That little door weather stripping thing. Also, when you open the door, you have this sort of crappy generic looking plastic trim on the door sill, which just doesn't really look all that nice, especially for $56,000. And frankly, there's a lot of cheap plastic throughout this interior. You have nice durable materials where it really counts, but there's still cheap plastic in the center console or on the base of the dashboard, the turn signal lever. You have some cheaper stuff in here. Now, for most people who buy this car, they're not going to care. They just want a cool off-road vehicle that can get dirty, take them out into the wilderness, and that's exactly that. And I think this stuff is perfect. But I hear a lot of like rich people talking about, oh, I'm going to go get a Bronco because it's the cool new toy and I'm going to have one and love it. And I fear they might be a little disappointed with the quality level in here, especially if they're coming from like a Land Rover Defender or Mercedes G-Wagon. This ain't like that. This is a lot closer to a Jeep Wrangler than it is to those kind of higher end SUVs. So just understand, you're not going to be getting the highest quality vehicle in the new Bronco. That's kind of the point of it. But I fear that some people who are wrapped up in the hype might be having a different expectation for how this will end up. It's not exactly luxurious. And next up, we move on to the back seat in the new Bronco. And I have to say, rear seat room is adequate. It's not exactly huge back here, not tremendously luxurious, but I have the front seat where I would be sitting if I was driving at about 6'3". And you can see I fit back here and my knees just are behind the front seat. My headroom is okay, but it's not like a back seat people are gonna be lying down in sitting in luxury. And that's important to mention because if the four doors rear seat room is only roughly adequate for adults in the back, you should really only get the two-door model if you really plan to almost never carry around people in the back seat, since the four-door isn't exactly huge. Interestingly though, in terms of comfort, probably the most noticeable item back here is that the rear seat back seems to be unusually upright. You're kind of sitting very upright. Now, I don't mind that. I like a good upright seat when I'm in a car, but some people might, and I don't see any way of controlling it or changing the angle of this seat back, so expect to sit upright in the back of the new Bronco. But anyway, other interesting things in the back seat. For one, on the back of the front seats, you can see all these little holes, this like lattice pattern. You're supposed to be able to attach stuff back here if you want. You can kind of clip it onto this and let it hang off the back seat for easier access for front or rear passengers. You also have power ports back here, which is really nice. You have USB-C and USB-A on the left, and you have a household style power port in the back, which is a really nice feature to have. You can plug in all sorts of devices while you're being driven along in the back of the Bronco. And worth noting, one other important item with the back seats, folding them down is tremendously easy. You just press this little button on the side of the headrest to fold that down, and then you just lift this little latch on the side of the seat, and then the entire seat folds down basically flat. Very, very easy to do. And worth noting, it's a 60-40 split back here for folding, as you can see. That means the rear seat doesn't just fold as one unit. You could theoretically put someone back here and still fold down the rest of the back seat for extra cargo space, which is nice to have. And next up, we move on to the back of the new Bronco. And I'm going to get into the cargo area in a sec, but first I want to talk about some of the other interesting items in the rear, starting with the roof. Now, the entire hard top in the new Bronco is removable, just like it is in the Jeep Wrangler. I only mentioned the front and rear sections because they're more easily removable, but you can also remove the back. It just gets more challenging because obviously these are larger pieces back here, a little bit more difficult to access, and you're contending with like the rear glass and its hinges, the rear wiper, the rear washer, that kind of stuff. It's not something you want to remove very often, and I suspect that people who get the hard top will either never remove it or like take it off once and pretty much leave it off, like most people do with their Jeeps. If you want a top top that's easily and quickly removable, you're probably gonna want the soft top model. I have taken down the top on a soft top Bronco, and frankly, it's really easy to do. Obviously more wind noise, etc., but if you really want that frequent convertible top on, top off, that's the one you're gonna want. Now, the rear design of the new Bronco is rather interesting to me because it's not really all that distinctive. When you have the top in place and this giant spare tire in back, there's not really that much space left over for identifying marks. You have to put brakelets on, you gotta put a license plate in, and that doesn't give them much space to tell you it's a Bronco like you might want. And you can see you have the Ford badge and the Bronco badge, and that's about it. Nothing particularly Bronco-ish back here. In fact, from the rear, if you were to take off those emblems, you might confuse this for a Jeep Wrangler. There aren't that many differences, and I suspect civilians, non-car people, won't really know that this is a Bronco when they just come up behind it. And it's not like you can put on a tire cover that says Bronco in giant lettering across the center, because the backup camera sticks out from the center of the spare tire just like it does in the Wrangler. That means any tire cover that goes on the back, you gotta cut out a hole in the middle for the backup camera, or else you're not gonna be able to use it. With that said, one very distinctive feature compared to the Wrangler is the lighting back here. You have a distinctive looking brake light setup, more vertical than the one in the Wrangler, and especially an unusual turn signal design. Kind of strange, not just like a circle or a square, but it has a little more design style to it. So that is one easy way to tell apart the Bronco from the back, of course. But anyway, next up we move on to the cargo area itself. One interesting item is the tailgate, starting with the tailgate handle, which is unusual. It's actually just a regular door handle, but mounted vertically instead of horizontally. You can see here, this is the front door handle of the car, and then you can see here, this is the tailgate door handle, and they've even flipped up the little button that locks the door, and so it's mounted sort of sideways as well, because it's just a front door handle turned 90 degrees. But anyway, next up, let's get into the cargo area. The first step is to obviously pull on the handle here, and you open up this swinging tailgate. As you can see, it swings out back and to the side. Now, a couple of interesting things to note here. For one, this swinging tailgate doesn't have to open all the way, meaning that if you're like in a parallel parking spot or you're in a tight place with a car behind you, you can open it only this far, and that way you can still load stuff in without damaging the car behind you or a building or whatever else you might be parked next to, so you can still get stuff in without opening the tailgate all the way, which is pretty cool. You can also open the tailgate more than 90 degrees if you want. You can push it all the way open on the side, which could help you if you want to load stuff in from the curb so the tailgate door isn't like blocking you from loading it in, because you can open it further than 90 degrees. Unfortunately, one interesting drawback of this tailgate design becomes apparent when you try to open the rear glass above the tailgate. Now, this rear glass isn't like latched in place by anything. It's only kept in place by the tailgate being closed. So when it's open, you just open up the rear glass, except you can't. You see, when the tailgate is open only a little bit, the rear glass won't clear it over on the side, and so you can't get it open. Instead, in order to open the rear glass, you have to open the tailgate basically all the way, and only then can you open up the rear glass. Now, the drawback to this is if you want to open the rear glass when you're in a tight parking space, you're parallel parked, you probably won't be able to. You probably won't be able to swing the tailgate far enough to open up the rear glass if there's something directly behind you. Kind of annoying. But anyway, once you're in the cargo area, you can see it is huge back here. A function of this vehicle's boxy shape is just a lot of space in the cargo area, and you can stick basically anything you want back there. And of course, you can fold the seats down, like I showed you earlier, for even more cargo space, and you can see with the seats down, it is really big back here. You could use the Bronco as kind of an enclosed pickup truck if you want. Worth noting, there's also a little bit more storage space underneath the floor. As you can see, lift this up, and you have some extra storage, and this is where the jack is also for tire changes, under the floor in the cargo area. Also worth noting, in this cargo area, you do have a 12-volt outlet back here, although it's a cigarette lighter style outlet. Unfortunately, no like household power outlet. That would be cool to have, but you don't have it here. But that's the basic gist of the cargo area. Now, one other interesting item in the cargo area, you can see obviously the Bronco logo on this giant floor mat back here, but if you look closer, you could also see the Bronco logo sort of hidden in the rear cargo area light. In between the little lights, there's a little Bronco. And in fact, this Bronco has quite a few little Bronco-related Easter eggs all around it, which are neat to spot and see. My very favorite one comes when you open the fuel door. You can see all of the old original Bronco body styles, sort of profile images in there with their original like model code showing what the Bronco originally looked like back in the day. So every time you refuel your Bronco, you can think about its heritage. And next up, since I'm outside the new Bronco, let's talk over some other interesting exterior items. One is the mirrors, which actually stay in place when you open the door. The door opens and you can see nothing happens to the mirror. And even if you open the door all the way, it doesn't collide with the mirror, it just stays put. Now the reason for this is when you detach the door, since it's removable, the mirrors stay in place so you can pull the doors off and still have the mirrors in. You can't do that in the Jeep Wrangler. When you take off the doors in a Wrangler, the mirrors go with them, and so you either don't have mirrors or you have to put on some aftermarket solution, but in the new Bronco, the mirrors are in place even with the doors off. And next up, another interesting item up front is of course the grill. There are several different grill options depending on which Bronco model you choose. I personally love this one. It says Bronco across the front very clearly and obviously. Looks kind of old school, upright, pretty neat. And you have the LED turn signals coming off of Bronco on either side, sort of flanking it, which looks cool. And you have these circular headlights, which is also an old school feature. And I love how all of that stuff looks in the front. It really gives it a very distinctive front image as opposed to the back, which, like I said, is a little bit more generic. You won't say generic about the front. One other interesting front item is these little like panels on the front fenders with a little window in them. They are very strange. What they're for is you're supposed to tie like a cord or a wire from those all the way up to the roof racks. And then if you're off-roading through the jungle, that wire will kind of push tree branches out of the way so it doesn't break your windshield. Nobody will ever use this feature. It's ridiculous. It's not useful for 99.9% of people. And it's kind of strange that they made such a relatively useless feature into such an obvious design detail. Everybody who walks up to the car notices those, comments on them, asks about it, even though they're not really all that practical. But last thing I want to talk about on the outside is the styling of this car. Frankly, I love it. And so does basically everybody else. Car styling is never universal, but this has been widely acclaimed. Everybody loves the brawny look of it, muscular and kind of old school retro, still boxy and off-roady, which a lot of SUVs aren't these days. Ford really hit a home run with this and managed to create a very distinctive vehicle that still looks like old Broncos, but is modern and cool. It's a fantastic job. I'm very impressed with it. With that said, I want to make one important point. I've now seen several of these new Broncos, and it's become clear to me that even though the regular design is pretty cool, the Sasquatch model is really cool. That's the one with all the off-road stuff, wider fenders, bigger tires, comes with 35s. Those look awesome. And frankly, when you see a non-Sasquatch Bronco, it doesn't quite have that like visual pop that the Sasquatch models have. These are still cool, they're great cars, and they're gonna be fun to drive and own, whatever, but the Sasquatch is the one you really want, especially if you wanna make that visual impact. It's the most capable off-road, and frankly, it's the coolest looking by far. And next up, we move under the hood in the new Bronco, and you can see this one's engine is the base engine. That's a 2.3-liter turbo four-cylinder with about 300 horsepower. Now, like I mentioned, this Bronco has a manual transmission, and the only way to get the manual is to get the base engine. But if you're willing to go automatic, you can also upgrade to a 2.7-liter turbo V6 with 330 horsepower. Those differences don't seem dramatic, 300 to 330, but the torque figure is substantial. This engine, the base, only has about 310 pound-feet of torque, but the V6 has 400 pound-feet. And V6 models are noticeably quicker. This is just about the slowest configuration you can get a Bronco in. The four-cylinder with four doors does 0 to 60 in like the low 8-second range, but if you get a V6 with the two-door body style, you can do 0 to 60 in like the low 6-second range, which is pretty quick, and a lot faster than a Jeep Wrangler if you're interested in speed from your Bronco. And finally, since I'm talking powertrain, I want to move on to the very last item here, and that would be the transmission, the manual transmission. Now, I'm saving this for last because virtually nobody is really ordering these with manual transmissions. I don't think this is going to be relevant for most people. I'm hearing like 5% of new Broncos are being sold with three pedals, but it's worth covering anyway in case you're interested. This is a 7-speed manual transmission, interestingly, but first is actually a crawler gear. You can see reverse is up and to the left, and C for crawl is down and to the left. And to access the crawler gear, you have to pull up on the base of the gear lever, like the shift lockout, just like you would in order to get into reverse. They really don't want you to accidentally activate the crawler gear because it truly is a crawler gear. You can see like 12 miles an hour is about 4,000 RPM. You really only want to use this feature if you're in a situation situation where you need a lot of power at low speeds, like if you're off-roading or trying to pull a stump out of the ground, that's when you'll use your crawler. Now, the manual transmission works pretty well, and I'll talk more about it during the driving experience, although there's one thing that's annoying, and that would be the parking brake. This car doesn't have like a regular parking brake you pull up. Instead, it's a little electronic parking brake over on the side to the left of the wheel below the dashboard, and that just doesn't gel all that well with the manual transmission. I like an old school normal parking brake, but obviously Ford wasn't going to create one of those just for the small percentage of customers who are getting the manual version. And so those are the quirks and features of the new Ford Bronco. Now it's time to get it out on the road and see how it drives. All right, here we go, driving the new Bronco. First impression when you get inside, I've had a lot of people sit in this car and drive it, ride it, whatever. Everybody says the same thing. It feels like you're like the king of the road in here, basically. You're sitting next to this upright dashboard. You got this big square windshield. You're looking out over a square hood with those little windshield extender rope things at the bottom. It really looks, you really feel tough in the new Bronco in a way that you don't really in the Wrangler. Not to say that the Wrangler isn't tough, but it's not quite the same for sure. Next up, and probably the most surprising thing, this engine is great. When Ford announced they were putting this engine in the Ranger, I kind of laughed at it. I was like, a Ranger with a four-cylinder, 2.3 liter, it's gonna be stupid. Well, I drove that and loved it. Then they announced they're putting it in this as the base engine. I'm like, that's ridiculous, it's gonna be huge, it's not gonna work. Well, it does work. This engine is one of the great engines on the car market, one of my very favorite engines in any car on sale today. It drives tremendously well. It has a great acceleration curve, it has a great torque curve, it feels great. And obviously this engine will be the one for fuel economy. If you're not really looking for great, huge power, whatever, this engine should be able to be just fine. Now, the manual transmission drives fantastically. Great clutch, super easy to use, great shifter, everything is great. Really impressed with it, actually. So if you do get the manual, you'll really like it. This does have adaptive cruise control, which is unusual in manual transmission cars, but the way that that works is it turns off around 20 miles an hour, so you can't use it for stop and go traffic, obviously. Wind noise is definitely there. Even with the hard top, which obviously is expected to have less wind noise than the soft top, you still hear stuff. And it's interesting, a lot of people have asked me over the last year and a half, oh, you shouldn't have gotten the Defender, you should have waited for the Bronco, it's so much cooler. It is cooler, but I'm validated in my decision now because this is way more towards Wrangler than towards anything like the Defender or the G-Wagon. This, it rides harsher than I expected it to. It rides better than the Wrangler, but not that much. The steering and handling is way better than the Wrangler. The Bronco has better suspensions. That's not really a big surprise, but you can really tell. The Wrangler steering is way vaguer than this. This is a lot better in terms of steering, but the ride quality is still pretty harsh. You still feel a lot of bumps, not incredibly comfortable. And it just isn't like a nice, luxurious experience in here. You're getting wind noise, you're hearing tire noise, even with these 33-inch tires. I imagine with the Sasquatch, you're gonna get even more. It's not terrible, it's totally live-withable. You could daily this car, no problem, and not ever have an issue. But if you're used to something nice and you're kind of coming back into this because you want the hype of the Bronco, like I mentioned earlier, you might be a little bit disappointed. Overall, I gotta say, I'm really impressed by this. It certainly drives better than the Jeep. The technology is way better in here than a Jeep. The interior looks more modern, looks newer, looks nicer. This powertrain, the 2.3 liter four-cylinder, I can't believe I'm saying it, but it's great, it's fantastic. I still would probably upgrade to the V6, but if you don't, you won't get hugely penalized. There's a lot of great things to say about this car. There's not much bad to say about it. And so that's the new Ford Bronco. This is great. And it's finally a credible, serious alternative to the Jeep Wrangler. And timing couldn't have been better in the end. It's coming out just as SUVs are all the rage, and especially off-roader SUVs. For the tens of thousands of people out there who have deposits on a Bronco and you're waiting, or if you're thinking about buying one, you're gonna love it. It is fantastic. And now it's time to give the new Bronco a DOUGSCORE. Starting with the weekend categories and styling, the Bronco is cool and tough. Not beautiful, but it looks nice and it gets a 6 out of 10, though I think a 2-door Sasquatch would get a 7. Acceleration with the manual and the 2.3 liter to 0 to 60 in the 8-ish second range, so it gets a 1 out of 10. Handling is fine and it gets a 4 out of 10. Fun factor is huge, there's so much you can do with this. It's a convertible and an off-roader and just a fun around town driver. It gets an 8 out of 10. Cool factor, it's very cool, especially right now, and it gets a 7 out of 10, though look for this number to come down
down as these become more common. Anyway, total weekend score is 26 out of 50. Next up are the daily categories and features. It's well equipped, not totally loaded with everything, but it has good tech and it gets a 6 out of 10. Comfort is okay, the ride is harsher than I expected, but it's fine and it gets a 5 out of 10. Quality is decent, but not amazing. Lots of plastics, not the nicest stuff as you might expect, and it gets a 6 out of 10. Practicality is good, normal for an SUV this size, and it gets an 8 out of 10. Finally, value, and these are expensive, but they're also super cool and exciting, and money well spent to have the coolest SUV on sale right now. It gets a 7 out of 10 for a total daily score of 32 out of 50. Added up, and the Doug score is 58 out of 100, which places it here against off-roader SUVs. The Bronco beats out the Wrangler, the Gladiator, and the 4Runner TRD Pro. The Bronco scores better than the Wrangler in weekend and daily categories, and it would do even better if I had tested the 6-cylinder with stronger acceleration numbers. Make no mistake, the Bronco is the best off-roader SUV on sale right now, and it's also the coolest.